So welcome you all in this lecture. Today we are going to see pulse width modulation and the use of Arduino pulse width modulation in DC motor speed control. Let's start. As an introduction part, I'm going to cover what is the meaning of modulation, what are the advantages of modulation, what are different types of modulation, and why we are using the pulse width modulation. Modulation is a technique that is mainly used in the communication. Communication means we want to transfer a signal from one location to another location. For that, on transmitting side, we use a transmitter. While on receiving side, we use a receiver. Then the transmitter and receiver have the communication by means of technique called as a modulation. Modulation is a new technique. Before modulation, there was very difficult to transfer a signal from one location to another location. You might have been knowing in earlier days, we were using the television sets when only Doordarshan was there. People used to have the antennas at their terrace, and everybody was required to point the antenna to the TV center located in that city. Now that TV center was having one antenna which is at sufficiently higher height. The TV center was transmitting a signal in a radius of say 10 kilometer or 25 kilometer range. So if you see all the houses antenna in all direction, they were always pointed to the TV center. Now this is called as a point-to-point communication. Now in order to get point-to-point communication, you might have seen that when the people were not able to get the signal, they used to increase the height of antenna by means of some adjustment. So here I want to say that this in point-to-point communication, the distance plays very important role. Also the height of the antenna. But let me explain with one example. As everybody know that there is a relation between frequency and the wavelength of a signal. We know that C is given by F into lambda. Okay. If I solve this equation, I get lambda is equal to C by F. This is equation number one. Let me give an example of three signals which are having frequency. First signal is having frequency of 1 kilohertz. Second signal is having frequency of say 100 kilohertz. And the third signal is having the frequency of 1 megahertz. Let's start with this. Suppose I am interested in calculating the wavelength for all these three signals. So for first signal, the wavelength will be given by C divided by F. The value of C is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second divided by this frequency. This frequency is 1 kilohertz. I can write it in the power of 10 as 10 to the power 3. Similarly, the equation for the second signal will be 3 into 10 to the power 8. As this is 100 kilohertz, the 10 will be having the power of 5. So that is 10 to the power 5. And for third case, it will be given by 3 into 10 to the power 8 divided by 10 to the power 6 as it is only megahertz. Let's find this value. After solving this, we get that this is equal to 300 into 10 to the power 3. This is equal to 3 into 10 to the power 3. And this is equal to 3 into 10 to the power 2. The height of antenna was used to have this relation, and that relation was the length of antenna should be equal to the quarter of the wavelength of signal to be transmitted. So if I am interested, how much will be the length of antenna needed to transfer a signal of 1 kilohertz, 100 kilohertz and the 1 megahertz? Then in that case, let's find out the length. The length for the first signal of 1 kilohertz will be given by L is equal to lambda by 4, as the lambda is 300 into 10 to the power 3 divided by 4. 300 divided by 4 comes out to be 75, and 10 to the power 3 is 1000. So length of antenna here needed will be 75,000 meter. Just remember this one. The length of second antenna for the signal of frequency 100 kilohertz will be, this will be 3000 divided by 4. And if you calculate, the answer comes to be 750 meter. This is the length of second antenna. Then the length of third antenna, if you calculate, it will be 300 divided by 4. So length of third antenna will be just 75 meter. Remember, if you are interested in transmitting low signal, the height of antenna needed is in thousands of the meter, and that is very difficult to design such a higher height antenna. If you go in the range of say 0.1 megahertz or 100 of kilohertz range, then still it is very high value, that is of 750 meter. And when you go for very, very high frequency, then only the height of antenna is somehow less than the 100. What I want to tell you here is that we used to transfer a signal from transmitter to receiver. Those signals are mainly transport, which are having the low frequencies, means this scenario is there. And such low frequency signals which are transmitted from transmitter to receiver are called as an information signal or the baseband signal. One best example of your information signal is nothing but the speech. Suppose we are interested in transmitting a speech. If you see the human speech frequency ranges from 0 to 4 kilohertz. So that is in the range of 4 kilohertz. If I require to find out the height of antenna for the 4 kilohertz frequency range, it will be around 4 times of 75,000. 75,000 4 times becomes near about 3 lakh meter. So 3 lakh meter of antenna to be designed practically is very difficult. You cannot design it. So what is to be done in such scenario? When people think about a technique, and that technique is called as a modulation. So what is a modulation? Here in modulation, as an earlier example, I explained that when we use a very high frequency signal, the height of antenna is very, very less. For example, for 1 megahertz frequency range, the height of antenna was needed 75 meter. In modulation techniques, what people do, instead of transmitting the baseband signal, which is of very low frequency, which will require 1000 of meter of antenna, the people used to transfer a very high frequency signal. Because by sending, say, a very high frequency signal of 1 megahertz, it will require only 75 meter height of antenna. So in this technique, we use two type of signal. One signal is called as a carrier signal, which is nothing but very high frequency signal. And that signal, as I said, will be in the range of 1 megahertz range, so that the height of antenna will be 75 meter or less than 100 meter around. And we used to change the property of that high frequency signal with the small signal, or called as a modulating signal or the baseband signal. Suppose I'm speaking something, so I'm not going to transfer the signal which I spoke. What I will do, that I will transfer a very high frequency signal, but I will change properties of that high frequency signal as per I spoke into the small signal. Now here, if you take any signal, that signal will be having different parameters. For example, as we know, the parameters associated with any signal is nothing but the amplitude. The maximum value taken by the signal in a vertical direction from the horizontal reference axis is called as an amplitude. Then second is the time. The amount of time required for a signal to cover one cycle is called as a time. Wavelength and frequency we just have seen. The frequency is calculated by inverse of the time, and you can calculate wavelength by using the formula lambda is equal to C by F. And third is width of the signal. Width of the signal, I'm interested in saying that whenever signal going to complete one cycle, in one cycle or in one time period, it will have some part in a higher side, that is positive half cycle, and it will have some part in on the lower side, that is called as a negative half cycle. Then how much is the width, or for how much duration it is having the high amplitude, that is called as an on time period, or the width of on time period. And for the time period for which it will be having the low value or the negative value, that will be called as a width of the low time period, or the T off, width of time off. So T on and T off are the two parts which, when we add together, it gives me the complete time period. So remember, time, total time is equal to on time period, which is the high value of the signal, plus T off, which is the low value of the signal. With the help of the modulation, with the example we have seen, the height of antenna comes down. So when we use a modulation, we are not required to have the very large height of the antenna. So this is one biggest advantage of modulation. Second, as we are changing the property of the high frequency signal, as with the information signal or the baseband signal, so it is at sufficiently higher power value. So it is going to avoid the mixing of signals or the mixing of noise which is present in the environment. Further, it increases the range of communication, because as we are using the high frequency signal will be having the higher energy, and with high energy, the signal can transfer a longer distance. Let me give an example of a small baby. Suppose there is a small baby of 3 years old, and you decided to go on walk for say 2-3 kilometers, and the baby says that no, I'm going to walk at my own. Then in that case, after some 1 kilometer, you will come to know that the baby is walking very slowly, and you will just get fed up of that situation. What you will do, you will just pick up that baby in your arm, you will start walking faster. Here you can think about the baby like a small, your information signal or the speech signal, which has very low capacity, low frequency. It cannot walk a longer distance, whereas you as a carrier, as a high frequency signal, when you picked up that signal, that information, as you are high frequency signal, you can walk to the longer distance. So always remember, using the carrier of megahertz range is going to give you the range of communication, increase the range of communication. Further, it is also possible to have the multiplexing. I'm not going to discuss on this point, because in that case, the discussion will be completely communication oriented. Here, I'm interested in this last advantage. And this last advantage says that the properties of one signal can be controlled using the other signal. This is what the advantage of modulation, and the same technique we are going to use in PWM. So remember this line, I will explain further. So what are different types of modulation? If you see here, the examples are given as amplitude modulation, frequency modulation, phase modulation, and the pulse width modulation. In amplitude modulation, whatever this signal is shown, this signal is megahertz frequency signal, it is a carrier, and whatever this blue color is shown, it is a low frequency signal, that is what the speech signal. So as per the change in your speech signal, what we do is that we change the amplitude of the carrier, so that when we just trace the peak points of your high frequency carrier, you are going to reconstruct a signal which will be same to as that of the low frequency signal. As the amplitude of carrier is changed here, it is called as amplitude modulation. In same fashion, if you see here, the frequency has been changed. So whenever your signal, suppose we are interested in transmitting this square wave, the square wave is having on period here, that is high value here and low value here. When there is a high value, we just have the increase in the frequency, that is we compress the signal. And when there is a low value, we dilute the signal, we just decrease the frequency. As of result, what is seen is that the frequency is modulated, frequency is going to change. And this is an example of the frequency modulation. So in phase modulation, what happens is that the phase of your carrier signal, the high frequency signal, is varied as per the change in your baseband signal. As we have seen three examples of the modulation, that is amplitude modulation, frequency modulation, and phase modulation. Let's see the fourth type of modulation, which is called as the pulse width modulation. I hope you got an idea by the meaning of modulation, as it is said pulse width modulation. So definitely by changing the width of the pulse, we are going to change the another signal. The pulse width modulation is mainly used when we want to control the power delivered to the analog device using the analog or digital devices, mostly in case of microcontrollers, as the microcontrollers are digital devices and we want to control the peripherals out of that, which may be the analog, for example, the DC motor, which is an analog device. So when you want to control the speed of such analog devices using digital devices, then pulse width modulation is a very important technique where we are going to control the average power transfer to the analog devices. So the advantage of pulse width modulation is that it is having very high efficiency. It is very efficient in controlling the analog devices. It has low power loss because it uses the low power signal, low power devices such as the MOSFETs. So its design is a MOSFET based. So that's why as MOSFET consumes very low power, so it is having very low power loss. And it is having ability to control the analog devices very precisely. Let's see what is the duty cycle. Duty cycle is given by the formula that duty cycle is equal to T on divided by total time period of signal multiplied by 100%. So here the total time is nothing but T on plus T off, and it is multiplied by 100, and the symbol of percentage is there. So whenever we take a square wave, let me give an example of a square wave. Suppose this is a square wave, then here the time period of square wave will be shown from this edge to this edge. No doubt you can show from this edge to this edge also, but we are considering, see here, this part is going to have the on time period of the signal. So this will be called as a T on, and this time period will be called as a T off. So now the duty cycle, as it is given, when this duty cycle gets multiplied by the change in signal, that is maximum value of the signal minus minimum value of the signal. So what we get is nothing but the average voltage. So this is going to give me the average voltage. So let me take an example. Suppose I'm having a signal which is varying from 0 to say 9 volt. Okay, so in this case it will be 9 minus 0. The range of the signal will be from 9 to 0. So the range of the signal will be 9 minus 0. And this will be multiplied by, let's say, the duty cycle of the signal is nothing but 25%. So I'm going to multiply by this to 0.25. So what we get, that 9 divided by 4. So value will be 2.25 volt. So in that case, the average voltage of 2.25 volt will be given when the duty cycle of the signal is 25%. If I make the duty cycle of the signal 50%, then the average signal will be transferred will be double of this, that will be 4.5 volt. If we make a duty cycle of 75%, the average signal will be triple of this. And if we make the duty cycle of 100%, the average signal transmitted will be equal to the 9 volt. So in pulse width modulation, we use a pulse signal which is having the different duty cycle. Different duty cycle means we are changing the width of the signal. As we change the width of the signal, we are able to change the average power delivered to the analog signal. The average power is given by average voltage into the current. So in order to get the average, if we assume the current is constant, then the average power will depend upon the average voltage. The average voltage is given by the change in the voltage from, that is what, the maximum value minus minimum value is multiplied by the duty cycle of the pulse, and that is what will be giving you the average voltage. Let's assume this signal, this pulse is changing from 0 to say 10 volt. So in that case, the range V max minus V min will be equal to 10 minus 0 equal to 10. When this 10 is multiplied by duty cycle, in first case duty cycle is 0%, so average voltage transferred will be 0 and your motor will be off. In second case, the duty cycle is 10%, so this range 10 multiplied by 10%, that is 0.1, gives you 1 volt. So at 1 volt, the motors will be rotating, that is very slow speed will be obtained. With this 25% duty cycle, when 10 multiplied by 25% duty cycle, that is 0.25, we get 2.5 volt. There will be a slight increase into the speed of the motor. With 50% duty cycle, it will become 5 volt. With 80% duty cycle, this average voltage will become 8 volt. And with 100% duty cycle, the full power will be transferred, that is 10 volt. Full speed will be obtained in this case. So remember, by changing the duty cycle, in short, in other words, by changing the width of the signal, we are controlling the speed of the motor. This is called as a pulse width modulation. Remember, this average voltage not only depends upon the width of the pulses, but it also depends upon the switching frequency. That is, if you are using any switch or if you are using any switching device such as a MOSFET, BJT or relay, then at what rate you are going to switch it on and off, that will decide the average voltage transferred. So remember, average voltage not only depends upon the width of the signal, but it also depends upon the switching frequency. Let's see different applications of pulse width modulation. Number one, in India, during Diwali period, you have seen the dimming of light and getting brightness of light. So that dancing of light from low light to the high brightness, that is achieved with the help of the pulse width modulation. Also, for any analog output, if you want to control from the 0% to the 100%, then that can be also done using the digital signal. Further, pulse width modulation is also used to generate different audio signals. For example, if you want to generate a low frequency signal to the high frequency signal, then in that case, PWM is also used. Then for providing the variable speed of the controlling the motors, this PWM is mostly used. In remote control also, to control the infrared LED, so to have different frequencies to be transmitted by the IR remote, we use the pulse width modulation effect over there. So these are not only the application, there are tremendous application, but I try to list here some few important applications. Further, for any application, the choosing appropriate duty cycle and appropriate switching frequency, that is a big challenge, and it again varies from one application to other application. In order to generate PWM signals out of these devices, you can use BJT, MOSFET, op-amp, IC555, or even the microcontrollers. Nowadays, mostly the ICs are preferred based on the MOSFET because it consumes very low power. So here you can use the op-amp or the comparator as a pulse width modulation generator. So in this figure, you can see the comparator is used without any feedback. So it is called as an open loop configuration. We are not giving any signal out from output to the input. So it is not using any feedback. It is also called as a open loop configuration. So here we are using a triangular waveform that is of 10 volt peak to peak voltage and of duration 0.5 millisecond, that is the time period is given. And this signal is compared with the threshold voltage of 1.40 volt. So whenever the input voltage goes higher than 1.40 volt, the output of op-amp switches to the higher state. And whenever the signal goes below 1.40 volt, the output of op-amp switches to the 0 volt. Like this, this signal is generated. So with a threshold of 1.4, you can see here, the on period is larger and off period is smaller. So it is having the higher duty cycle. In this example, now the threshold voltage has been changed to 4.5 volt. With increased threshold volt, what we obtain here is that the on period has been decreased. So whenever the input voltage will be larger than 4.5 volt, the output of op-amp will become high. And whenever it will be less than 4.5 volt, the output of op-amp will become low. Why this is happening? Because this op-amp is used in a non-inverting configuration. So as non-inverting voltage becomes greater than the inverting voltage, the difference is positive. That's why we get a positive output. Whenever the non-inverting voltage becomes less than the inverting voltage, the difference is negative. That's why we get a low output. So here, there is a decrease in duty cycle. In this example, we again increase the threshold voltage to 8.5 volt. And then again, we see the on period has been reduced tremendously and the off period is increased. So here it is having the very low duty cycle. If we use this threshold voltage as a varying voltage, then by changing the varying voltage for different values, we are able to control the width of the signal. That is, pulse width modulated signal is generated by controlling the threshold voltage. It is the simplest form of PWM generator. As we see here in IC555 based PWM generator, the IC555 is a timer IC. So the duty cycle depends upon only two resistors, that is R1 and R2. It is independent of all other components. So here the value of R1 is fixed as 1 kilo ohm and value of R2 is selected from the potentiometer. Here the potentiometer is set to the value of 51 kilo ohm. When these values are put into this formula, we get a duty cycle as shown here. Here you can see the almost on period and off period is same. Moving with next example, the potentiometer it changed to the 10 kilo ohm. Moving further, again, the resistance is decreased. As a result, the different waveform is generated. So let's move ahead with PWM in Arduino Uno. Now we know that in Arduino Uno, we are having total 14 output lines, that is 0 to 13. Now out of this, there are 6 lines are such that which are marked with a negation mark. That is nothing but those lines are called as a pulse width modulation lines, or also we call it as analog lines. So here you can use these lines if you want to control any analog device in your design. So in that case, by using the same principle of the duty cycle, the average power delivered to the analog device will be controlled. Here we are controlling the brightness of LED. So in order to control the brightness of LED, you need to change the voltage given to the LED. Remember, there is no relation in the current flowing through LED and the brightness of LED. The brightness is independent of current flowing through the LED, but it is depending upon the voltage. So you need to control the voltage. So you can assume here the current is almost constant. So it depends upon the what average voltage you are going to deliver to this LED. With here as a 0% duty cycle, you will find that the LED will be completely off. With 25% duty cycle, the average voltage will become 5 minus 0 is equal to 5 multiplied by, that is 0.25. So 5 into 0.25 gives you 1.25 volt. So there will be the LED glowing with very less brightness. Further, when duty cycle is increased to 50%, 5 minus 0, the range is 5. 5 multiplied by 0.5, the voltage will increase to 2.5 volt. We will see about a double brightness shown by given by the LED. Further, by increasing duty cycle to 75%, again there will be the increase in the brightness, and when the duty cycle will become 100%, you can see the full brightness of LED. So this is a simple example of PWM in Arduino Uno. You can see here the LED is connected to pin number 6 and it is grounded through a resistor of 220 ohm. Explain the Arduino code for this. So first line is hash define LED space 6. It tell you that at pin number 6 one LED is connected. In void setup, we are going to decide the direction of this LED. So by using pin mode command, the direction is specified as output. Then in void loop, we are using two for loops. The for loop is going to vary from 0 to 255 because the all digital lines are of 8 bit. Those are 2 to the power 8 gives you 256, means it varies from 0 to 255. The for loop is going to run from 0 to 255. Every time the value of I will be incremented, and we are going to write the value of I on this LED. So here, if you want to calculate how much voltage will go to the LED, you need to use a formula of the resolution multiplied by the reference voltage. The reference voltage will be the range, that is Vmax to Vmin, and multiplied by the resolution, resolution will be 1 upon 2 to the power 8. So whatever the number you give here, value of I, depending upon that, the resolution will be obtained. First loop is going to increase the brightness of LED, while the second loop is having the decreasing from higher value to the low value. So there will be the decrease in the brightness, and we are using a delay in both case of 20 milliseconds. Next, we are using PWM with the help of now potentiometer. So instead of controlling the brightness through the for loop, we can use a potentiometer externally. You can see the potentiometer is having three terminals. The extreme two terminals are connected to VCC and ground, where the middle terminal is connected to the analog channel, ADC channel A0. So whenever you will change a potentiometer pot, depending upon that, the value will be read by the ADC. Remember, the ADC is of 10 bit, so it can read the values from 0 to 2 to the power 10, that is, and whereas the LED, the analog device, is connected on the 8 bit pin, which is having the range from 0 to 255. So we require some mapping from the 1024 values to the 256 values. Let me explain the code for this. We are using hash define LED6, that is, LED is connected on pin number 6. Then hash define port A1, the potentiometer output is going to ADC channel A1. So there is a correction in the code, it should be A0. We are using a variable, that is receive RCV, and one more variable as LED value, LED underscore value. In void setup, we are going to define the direction of LED. So direction of LED using pin mode is defined as an output. The receive variable is used to get the value of the potentiometer. For that, we are using the command, that is analog read, R is capital. The variable is pot. Remember, the potentiometer is going to function like a voltage divider. That is the same example of two resistors connected in series, where one top resistor is connected to VCC and the bottom resistor is connected to ground, and the point of junction of two resistors is connected to the middle terminal. So the voltage across the lower resistor, which is connected to ground, that will be given by this middle terminal to the ADC channel A0. So we are reading that voltage with the variable RCV. Then we use a command, that is map. The ADC channel is A0, that is RCV. So ADC channel value we got on variable RCV. So that is in the range of 0 to 1023. And we want to get it mapped so that it will be delivered to the digital IO pin in the range of 0 to 255. So it does a mapping for each four values of your ADC. It is going to get one value. Then that value we are going to write on the LED by using the command analog write, W is capital. So analog write in bracket LED comma LED value. This mapped value will be written to the LED. With a delay of 10 milliseconds, the brightness will be controlled here. So here we are using a potentiometer and ADC channel so that the brightness of LED will be controlled. In next example, we are going to see the speed DC motor speed control using the Arduino PWM. So in order to control the DC motor speed, what is needed is that we require some additional component like a switch, as here given the MOSFET. Now here the PWM channel signal is given to the gate of the MOSFET. So depending upon the width of the pulse sent by this signal on gate, the MOSFET is going to decide how much average voltage will be given to this DC motor, and accordingly the DC motor speed will be controlled. For one more DC motor, one more additional component will be needed, and if you want to rotate the motor in either direction, it is difficult in this case. In order to rotate motor in another direction, you need to have the another setup and some relay mechanism in between or some another solution. So in order to make motor possible to rotate in both direction, there is a concept to use the H bridge. The H bridge is given in this figure below. So it is having totally four switches, as S1, S2, S3 and S4, and there is a motor connected here. Here you are going to give a positive supply, and on the bottom side the negative supply will be given. At a time, any two diagonal switches will be closed. Whenever you place a switch in any diagonal, the motor is going to rotate in a specific direction. For example, when the switch S2 and S4 is closed, the right hand side connection of the motor is going to get a positive supply and left hand side connection is going to get a negative supply. This will cause the motor to rotate in a clockwise direction. In second case, when switch S2 and S4 is open and switch S1 and S3 is closed, so that time the left hand side of the motor is going to get the positive supply and right hand side connection is going to get the negative supply. That is, the polarity is now reversed than the earlier case. So this time motor is going to rotate in opposite direction of the previous, that is in anti-clockwise direction. So this type of mechanism is called as an H-bridge. As you can see here, in order to control one motor, one way H-bridge is needed. Similarly, to control the another motor, one more H-bridge is needed. So manufacturer combined the two H-bridges in one module, and that module is called as a dual channel H-bridge motor driver module. So there are two types of module available in the market, as EL298N and EL293D. So using these two modules, so this module on right hand side is EL293D and the module on the left hand side is EL298N, and with the help of these modules you can control the speed of two DC motors where the robot is having only two wheels. So in order to control four wheels, we require such two modules. The most popular module is EL298N because it uses a heat sink, so power handling is better as compared to EL293D. So let me explain this module one by one. This IC, the main IC EL298N, which is having the heat sink. Then you are having a voltage regulator of 5 volt on board. There is one jumper is used for this voltage regulator. Also, in order to control the two motors, there are two connections given. This connection is for motor A and this connection is for motor B. You can connect the motors which can use a voltage from 5 volt to 35 volt. This pin is to be grounded and this pin can be used as an input as well as the output. Whenever we use the motors which uses the voltage less than or equal to 12 volt, that time this jumper setting should be there. So with this jumper setting, we can use this pin as a 5 volt output pin. That time this pin can be used as an output pin which can be connected to give the power supply to your Arduino Uno kit. Whenever the motor voltage is more than 12 volt, use this pin as a 5 volt input pin, and that 5 volt will be given as a supply to the internal IC so that the IC will be protected. Whatever be the voltage given here from 5 volt to 35 volt, every time this IC is having the consumption of 2 volt. For example, if you give here 15 volt, the motors are going to get 13 volt. So remember, if your motor is of 12 volt, you need to give here the 14 volt so that 2 volt will be consumed by this IC. Moving further, there are these connections given. You can see here two more jumpers are given. This first jumper is for enabling the motor A. The second jumper is for enabling the motor B. In 1 and in 2 is used to decide the direction of motor A. If this jumper is present, the speed of the motor will be the maximum. You cannot control the speed of the motor will be rotating at maximum speed. So if you are interested in controlling the speed of the motor, you need to remove these two jumpers. By removing these two jumpers, now if the enable is given 0, the motor will be completely disabled. No enable signal, the motor will be disabled, and with enable signal, different values of in1 and in2 will decide the direction of the motor. If you give in1 and in2 as a low voltage, 0 voltage, the motor will be stopped. Again, if you give the high voltage on both pins, the motor will be stopped. If you give in1 as a 0 and in2 as a 1, motor will be rotated in clockwise direction. And when you make in1 as 1 and in2 as a 0, the motor will be rotated in anti-clockwise direction. The same functionality is available for the motor B by using pin number 3 and pin number 4. And in that case, the enable pin will be ENB. So here in this case, we are using EL298N module. The two motors are used here and the connections are given as shown here using the breadboard and Arduino Uno. So these statements are given here to understand the connections. At pin number 5, the enable pin of motor A is connected. So this is a pin number 5. So this line, this green color line, is going to the enable A pin of the motor A. Similarly, on pin number 6, enable pin of motor B is connected. So this is pin number 6 is given by this violet color, and this violet color, if you trace, it is going to this connection, that is the ENB pin. Then INT1 and IN2 are connected to pin number 2 and 3. So this is pin number 2 and 3. So pin number 2 is using this brown color and pin number 3 is using this light pink color. So if you see trace these two wires, these are going to these two connections. Similarly, INT3 and INT4 are connected to pin number 4 and pin number 7. The pin number 7 is shown by the yellow color and pin number 4 is shown by the blue color. If you trace out, these are the connections. In same fashion, the VCC and ground is given. And let's see the Arduino code for this design. The first line is hash include Arduino.h. So if you are using some another compiler, you require the Arduino header to be called over there. So for that purpose, it is given. If you're using Arduino IDE, you can skip this line. The second line is hash include DCM driver 298H. So this is a library file for using the L298N driver. So we are going to define, as I explained, the enable A, INT1 and INT2 variables by name LM298N underscore ENA connected on pin number 5. Then LM298N underscore INT1 and INT2 connected to pin number 2 and 3. In same fashion, LM298N underscore ENB is connected on pin number 6. And LM298N, INT3 and 4 are connected on pin number 4 and 7. By using this DCM driver L298, we create one object, and that name of object is DC motor driver L298. That object is having data type of this header file. And we are going to pass the parameters in the bracket. The parameters are in this sequence given. That is L298N, that is enable pin of first motor, then INT1, INT2 connection of first motor, then enable pin of second motor, and INT3, INT4 connection of the second motor. With this, we are going to use one variable as a timeout. And this is having a timeout period of 10,000 milliseconds, that is 10 seconds. One character variable is used as a menu option. So here I'm going to explain you the code on the basis of the menu. Menu is like some program will run on your serial monitor or the LCD. Here I'm using the serial monitor, and it will ask you to give some input. Depending upon your input, it is going to run a particular code. Second variable to be used as a time, and it is used as a data type of long. Let me explain the void setup. So we are using the serial monitor at the baud rate of 9600. That's why the command is serial.begin9600. So till the serial communication is not present, it will try to set the baud rate. Once the serial communication is found, it will immediately print the message as serial.println start. So start will be shown on the LCD if you are using LCD. As we are using serial monitor will show that the system is ready and the message will be displayed as a start. And the menu option is going to have the menu. So the menu is inbuilt code, and that function is at the last of this code I will explain. So let me explain void loop. If the menu option is true, then the object dot set motor A and object dot set motor B command will be executed. So first parameter in the bracket is nothing but the speed of the motor, and second parameter is the direction of motor. The direction of motor will be clockwise if you set the value as 1, and it will be anti-clockwise if you set the value as a 0. The speed of the motor will be given value from 0 to 255. 0 will indicate the motor off, and the 255 will indicate the maximum power to be delivered. So depending upon that value, the PWM signal will be generated. Here we are using a delay of 2 milliseconds. So motor will be rotating at that speed as a test one for 2 milliseconds. Then after that, we are going to stop the motor. For that, the command is, we are going to call a function that is object dot stop motors. No parameters passed in the bracket. Again, the delay of 2 milliseconds. So whenever your code will be ready, the motors will be started for 2 milliseconds and it will turn off for 2 milliseconds. Now, whatever the time is there, so we are going to check this condition. So millis is going to give you the current time in milliseconds since you run the code. If that time and the time 0, that is what initial time we set to 0. If your code, this difference is larger than the timeout, suppose timeout is already done, then it will bring the control back to the menu option. If you don't provide any input, this is like a watchdog timer. So when the timer will be timeout, it will bring you back to the original main menu function. So what is that main menu function? Let me explain. First, it will ask you that what component you want to test. Second, it will ask you to enter as a 1 to test the DC motor. Further, it can ask you to enter any value, okay, or press the reset button. Now, this message will be displayed until the serial communication is available. Further, when serial communication will become available, that time, whatever the data is given by the user, whatever the function, whether you press 1 or any other variable, If you place one or any other number on any other character, that will be assigned to C. So now it is going to check the value of the C. Is it alphanumeric or not? So here restriction is that the character C should be the alphanumeric. Alphanumeric means either it will be having alphabets, you can enter the alphabets, or you can enter the numbers. If the value of C is 1, as it has been said that you have to enter 1 to test the DC motor. If you enter 1, then this loop, this condition is satisfied, and it will show you the message that testing the motor. So whenever this will be executed, remember the last code was like this. So when this function was executed, this was true. The motor was started for 2 milliseconds and motor was stopped for 2 milliseconds. So whenever this will satisfy that C is equal to 1, your motor will be started for 2 milliseconds. So if you give any other value than 1, then it will show you the message that the wrong input. And the current value of the millisecond duration will be assigned to the time zero variable. So we have seen so far what is a modulation, what are different types of modulation, what are the advantages of modulation, what is the amplitude modulation, then frequency modulation, phase modulation, pulse width modulation, then what is the advantage of pulse modulation. Then we have seen the pulse width modulation implementation using Arduino Uno to control LED brightness, also to control the DC motor speed. Now in Proteus, many students are implementing the design to control the DC motor using the push button switch. I need to give some hint in that designing that. So while using, while interfacing DC motor, I will suggest you people to use the relay. So use a relay over there to control the motor. So you can connect to relay two different supply. Okay, in case of normally open connection, you give the minus 12 volt supply, so the motor by default will be rotating in one direction, and whenever you excite the relay, as the relay gets activated, it will go to another pole connection, and there you can give a plus 12 volt supply, so your motor will be rotated in another direction. So by pushing the push button switch, you can achieve that logic. I hope you understand. You need to explore, use your own design strategies and get that assignment done. Okay, this much there for today. Thank you so much for attending this lecture. Have a nice day.